you wrote this amazing thread on this dog ramp business that you bought for $300,000. And in the last 2.5 years, you've sold $35 million worth of dog ramps.
Yes.
Right, so that is the headline. We're gonna break it down and everything in a second. Hey, Ramon, welcome to the show, man.
Awesome. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, look, so we have some mutual friends. I always see you on Sam Parr's Instagram doing some boxing, crazy stuff on there. And a bunch of people have been on the show. I've mentioned your name in the past, but I know you've kind of kept like a fairly low profile in a way and been focused on building your businesses and doing all this crazy stuff, which we're going to talk about today. But yeah, I mean, look, let's just paint a picture. The reason I, you know, heard of you in the first place was one, because I'd heard your name on the grapevine, but specifically with the business side, you wrote this amazing thread on this dog ramp business that you bought for $300,000. And in the last 2.5 years, you've sold $35 million worth of dog ramps.
Yes.
Right. So that is the headline. We're going to break it down and everything in a second. But like, first of all, man, like, just tell me a little bit about your background, because you're a European immigrant like myself, and you've landed in the States living the American dream, it looks like. So like, where did you kind of grow up and how did you land in the States?
Yeah, I grew up in a city called Den Haag, or how we say Den Haag in Holland. 12 years ago, I was in the States. I always wanted to move to the States. It always attracted me. Land of opportunity, the American dream. You know, I really loved the concept of, if you work hard, you know, you have a higher chance of you know, making it, quote unquote. And 12 years ago, made the leap overseas.
Let's talk a little bit about, I heard you mention your conversation with Sean Puri, who was also on the show, and he's got his own podcast as well, My First Million, great show. You talked a little bit about your childhood, right? And even when we just started this conversation in our like pre-call, like, if you don't mind me sharing, you said, look, I'm not even the smartest person. Look, I'm just like I'm the guy who keeps it simple. And you know, you've clearly made a success of yourself in the business world. And people who listen to the show know that that's like my favorite type of entrepreneur, right? Like, just like, keep it simple. Like, buying and selling stuff is kind of like what I started doing when I was a kid as well. But I'm just curious, like, if you're thinking of your like philosophy in business, like what does that look like to you? Because I feel like this is something you've probably like thought a lot about in the past.
Yeah. Because, you know, I always joke with Sean and Sam too, right? Like, I'm really not smart. I'm a high school dropout. Like, I, you know, technically, I was 15, but I already stopped going way before. I was a little bit of a trouble kid. And I'm also not super passionate about like one thing. Like, a lot of entrepreneurs start their journey because they're passionate about solving one problem or, you know, doing something. For me, I always say, like, I'm just obsessed and passionate about the process of solving something. Okay, we have a product, and it doesn't really matter what it is. It's a product, service, content. And it, for me, it's like a challenge on how to break it down and reverse engineer on how, okay, we have microphones that you use for podcasts. How can you sell that to the audience? And then that process, that's what I'm really passionate about. So that's why you see my career. I've done like so many things. I've sold piñatas. I've hosted EDM parties. I've had a construction company when I was 20 years old. I've done all kinds of stuff. Like, it's a huge list. Some of them huge failures. Most were like in between. And then I had like a couple, very few home runs, basically.
Yeah, and now, so let's call some of those out, because I know you've mentioned this soap opera website, I think, right?
Yes.
Which I don't know if this, you mentioned on another podcast, I think you sold it. You sold that one, right?
I sold that one, yes.
And are you allowed to share the amount you sold it for, or is that?
Yeah, it was close to eight figures.
Okay.
Yeah, and I bootstrapped
so
that.
So for people who are slow at math like me, that's like close to $10 million, right?
Yes.
All right, cool.
Yes.
Right, so that's a huge win for anyone, right? Like that's enough money for most people to, you know, not have to work again or be financially free, basically, right?
Yes. That was definitely, for me, that was like the life-changing exit. I had some other exits before of like a couple $100,000 and $400,000. And it's a lot of money, not to, you know, say it's not, but that's not really enough to call it life-changing. This was definitely life-changing because it was also full cash offer. Often when you see headlines of like, oh, this company bought this, if you don't know the financial terms, like often it's bought in stock or it's like an earnout of 10 years or et cetera. This was a full cash buyout.
And I'm assuming you owned majority of that, if not all of it, right? Because a lot times people hear a crazy number and they're like, so-and-so got bought for $50 million. But then when you look deeper, you know, either way, it's still a great thing most of the time. But sometimes it's, oh, that person owned 4% by the time it got to that stage because they diluted so much from venture capital. Or in some cases, I've had people on the show, like the founder of FanDuel, right? And like I think it was like $500 million, and he made zero pretty much from that because by then the valuation was already higher. So the money just goes to investors.
Oh,
so
yes.
Yeah, they're the worst.
I can tell so many stories of friends that, you know, that took VC money and then sold and basically walked away with nothing or very little. But yeah, the soap opera website, I bootstrapped myself and I owned. I had a couple advisors. So I had some advisory shares and I gave equity to employees, but it was like 95% I still owned.
Incredible, man. Yeah, that's obviously a huge win. So just the only reason I'm sharing that is to say, look, you've done a bunch of different things. You've clearly had some huge successes. And we're going to hone into today the process of buying and specifically growing a business, because we've talked with Andrew Wilkinson, Ryan Culp, and Ryan Beagleman about buying before. So if you're listening to this and you're really interested in, you know, all the kind of advanced stuff around how you buy through SBA loans and, you know, all that funky stuff, that's kind of the first part. But with you, I wanted to touch a bit on that, but really focus on the growth side. But before we get onto the dog ramp business, you mentioned construction, you know, the soap opera website, and you know, like a bunch of different companies you've had. One of the biggest things that kind of stands out to me is at one point you got into digital, though, right? Because construction can be an incredible business, right? But you know, to scale a construction company, you just need to hire more people, land more deals, and keep scaling that way. But with the internet, of course, there's, you know, much higher growth, and a lot of the focus of the podcast is on technology and the internet. So what was that moment for you where, you know, you said you're a 15-year-old high school dropout? I don't know if you were like a internet tech savvy kid at that age or not, but what was that moment where you saw the power of the internet and said, oh, I can like sell stuff on here, which was like a moment for you?
Yeah. Yeah, funny enough, before I started the construction company, I actually was a programmer. I actually talked myself into a company that was actually training developers at that time. This was before 2001, before the internet, you know, bubble, so to speak. And so for a couple of years, I learned myself with the help of the company to program. So I had some, you know, introduction to internet and, you know, development. Then I stopped doing some, you know, the internet bubble actually burst, lost my job. It was very difficult to get a job for me, especially as a high school dropout, as a developer. And that's how I actually started the construction company. But then years after, I I started a company with a friend of mine. It was an online travel agency. He already had the idea. I just came on board and started doing all the marketing for it. And that's how I started being reintroduced basically to, you know, at that time, the new ways of, doing internet marketing. This was before Facebook. So we had to, you know.
Yeah, what year was this roughly? Do you remember?
Fuck. 12 years ago. So maybe Facebook was around, but it was not like a common thing to drive tons of traffic. I'm not sure. But at the time, it was
like 2008, 9, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Cool. There was no like ads engine the way there is today or with the crazy targeting they have and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So you said you focused more on SEO at the time?
SEO, email, PR, things like that. Google AdWords was big for us.
Yeah, especially for travel, right? Like I know that's
yes.
I mean, booking.com is Google's biggest advertiser, I think, still.
So, yeah,
it's pretty crazy. So you had the technical skills. I know there was, it sounded like there was like a moment, we don't have to turn this into your life story therapy session, but
that's boring,
like
yes.
You had some stuff with your mom and you dropped out and I think she kicked you out of the house, you said, or something like that. And you kind of had to, find your way. If you don't mind me asking though, because like, I didn't have exactly the same thing, but I got suspended from school multiple times and kind of had a similar thing. And I was like fairly smart, but I was kind of a bit of a troublemaker at a certain stage because I was rebelling against the system. It was a longer story for me as well, so I don't want to bore people. But the only reason I bring that up, because I know there's someone listening to this who like associates with that too. Not to say it's a good thing. It's more to say if you're 15 listening to this and you're not crushing it in school but you've got interest, right? Like there's still a way for you to harness that energy into something positive, which is clearly what you did eventually. I'm curious though, like were there certain people that you met along the way or people that you were looking up to say, oh, that's a way I can follow what that person's doing, their kind of playbook? What was it at that age that was like turning you in the right direction? Because it's really easy to go the wrong way as well, especially at that age.
Yeah. Just like you said, not to go too long into it. Like at that age, unfortunately, I didn't have like a positive role model, or positive people that I would look up to. I was really, if anything, on the other side, basically, got in trouble with police and stuff like that. Nothing major, but it was like, it's the same in the UK. I mean, getting into fights and street fights and fist fights, right? It's more common in Europe than here in the US, I think. Especially in the neighborhoods I grew up, I don't want to call it super bad, but it was very rough, basically. You had to you had to stand up for yourself and you had to fight, basically. So I didn't have any like role model or like, oh, this is where I want to be particular. It always happened, one thing led to another. Like my mom sort of kicked me out or like told me like to move out. Now, okay, shit, I'm forced to make money to pay the rent, a stable income. Okay, let's find a job. Okay, I hate this job. What can I do to find a better job that has a higher career opportunity? Okay, let's just do that. So when I did move to the States, I think once I started, when I met Sam Parr first, that at that time was running the Hustle and HustleCon, that's actually, he was one of my first people that I met, like, oh, this is like people that I admire and, are much smarter than me. And, I can learn a lot from, but until that time, I did not have any connections or network or even like a role model per se.
Thanks for sharing that, man. I think it's definitely worth mentioning. Let's talk about this dog ramp business. So we're going to use that kind of as a case study. And in your thread, which I'll share in the show notes below, you talked about, the headline selling that many, $30 million worth of revenue. And then you also kind of said, right in the beginning, like it was a very specific problem, right? So for people who don't have dogs or don't know, you know, like the visual kind of shows you what it looks like. It's like a ramp from like the sofa to the floor or something, right? Like what right. was it that you saw in this business that you bought and you thought, oh, that's something I would like to own and there's a need for something like this?
Yeah. Well, the funny story is actually initially I was attracted to the website because I was not doing Facebook ads. I was not doing email marketing. The website was horrible. So I was more first initially attracted because of I saw, you know, four or five huge growth levers that I thought that I could, you know, just turn around. By the way, I never expected this to go from 300 to 35 million. And I think that's also an important thing that I've learned is like, none of my ideas were always $1 billion ideas. So I think once, because I've lived in San Francisco, or if you read Twitter, I think maybe people think or get the feeling that you need $1 billion idea to start something. And you, often you don't. You know, I bought the dog run business thinking, you know, we could maybe 5-10 exits with these levers. But when I started doing research, okay, Facebook ads, email marketing, website conversions, great. Then I looked at the product. I always like to sell product, like because Facebook ads is such an important channel, I look at the market size. Okay, pet owners, great. Then I look at the how are people spending within that product category. Pets as well. Pets is great because they more people are spending more on their pets. And then I was really fascinated because this is really, I didn't know this problem existed. I have a pet, but I have a big dog. So my dog doesn't really need a ramp, but I was never aware like, oh, actually dogs need this. This is actually a huge problem. That's when I really got excited about this listing because it has a niche problem that a lot of dog owners have.
So, and just for people watching on YouTube, you can see I'm sharing the picture right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I was like, wait, what's going on?
But that's the ramp. It's quite cute. And if you're only listening, click the link for the YouTube because it's worth seeing the picture anyway. But anyway, back to what you're saying. So yeah, you saw this very specific problem. And just to clarify, like, what is the benefit? It's not just like a fun slide for a dog, right?
Yes. So
it stops them from getting injured or something?
Yeah.
Or what?
Yeah. So there's twofold. So small dogs, and I've learned it along the way, but small dogs, especially with the little legs or short legs, it's actually really bad for their spines and joints to jump on and off high surfaces. It's the same if you and I will jump off the second floor you know, a million times every day, it's not going to be good for our backs. So dogs like Dachshunds and Pugs and a couple other breeds are very prone to get a disease called IBDD. It's a spinal disease. One in three Dachshunds get that. It's a very painful and expensive surgery. One of the things that a dog owner can do to prevent IBDD is, you know, not having your dog jump on and off furniture. So it's a pretty clear selling point. I don't like to sell based off fear, but it's like, hey, if you have a small dog, you have one in three chance that your dog will get IBDD. It's very painful and expensive. It can go up to $8,000. Here's a product that only costs $100 that, you know, could, you know, help you prevent this.
It doubles up as a fun slide
and it's fun too. Exactly.
It's good for Instagram for sure.
Yeah. And that's also what I saw, like, okay, in some products or categories just are much better for Facebook because it's very visual, right? That's why fashion, for example, really works well on Instagram, or makeup, or personal care, because it's very visual, you know, before and after pictures, and it's very, you know, glamorous. Versus if you sell an insurance service, you know, you cannot make fun videos. So using puppies and pets was just also like, yeah, this is an easy sell, basically.
And there's like an inherent, like, I hate to use this word, but like virality or like word of mouth anyway, because a lot of pet owners love posting pictures of their pets, right? Like,
Oh my God.
So that's like another kind of lever I'm sure you probably thought about.
Yeah, so user generated in the beginning, and we can go over the practical tactics that I use, but in the beginning, for months, we've not even shot any of our video ads. We just used user generated content. Oh, wow. That we didn't even ask for. People were just sending it to us because they, you know, love, like you said, they love their pets. And we actually built a Facebook group for our customers, or actually also non-customers, to share videos and pictures of their dogs. And you have no idea, like, we get one group is only about dachshunds, is 200,000 members. It gets over 5,000 posts every day. And most of them is just people posting pictures and videos of their dog.
That's insane.
And huge engagement. Other people interact with that too. Oh, this is so cute. Oh, your dog is amazing. How old? Like, it's really, people are passionate about their pets. Like
100%.
One of their most passionate, yeah.
Yeah, so you saw this problem and yep. But let's go into the buy versus build, right? Because I know you've started stuff from scratch. In this case, was the first time you saw this problem when you saw the business for sale, I'm assuming? It wasn't like a problem you found and then you're like, hey, let's go find a business. It was one listed on like Quiet Light or something like that.
Correct. So I always like to, even if I'm not in the market to buy, for some reason, it's like one of these strange hobbies of mine is to always look at listings and learn. And I'm just always fascinated, like, oh, a person built a crossword puzzle website and is selling it for 9 million. That's insane. How does he do that?
Crazy.
And right. So I came across this this listing. I was looking for something in the pets. So I was right away, you know, intrigued. And then I saw, you know, oh man, there's a huge opportunity here.
So in that scenario, like you looked at the, and it's quite like brokerage, right? They're the brokers in this case for this one. Or
I'm a very big fan of Quiet Light. I've bought and sold many through them. This particular one, I found on the other, through another broker.
Are you allowed to say a name or you prefer not to?
To be honest, I actually forgot. I don't think they're around anymore.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, that's cool. That's cool. But yeah, there's like 3-4 main brokers. And nowadays, even Micro Acquire is another one.
I love Micro Acquire. Yeah.
Yeah. Also sponsored the show. So thanks, Andrew, for sponsoring the show.
Shut up. Thank you, Andrew.
Yeah, yeah.
Send me some socks. I saw you.
yeah, he's been sending those out. But anyway, so just to go hone into that, right? Like very, very quickly, though, like you could look at that and say, hey, I'm going to start this from scratch. I'm going to go source a product. In this case, you said, well, there's already something that already works. People already buying. I can see the numbers. So that's the reason you buy it versus build, right?
Yeah, I get that question, especially after that tweet, quite often now. It's like, what makes you buy versus build? And I think there are a couple of things. A is like your skill set. Some people are really good at going from zero to one, right? The building phase. Others are better at scaling, going from one to 10. It also sometimes depends. Like if, for example, you have to look at how much time, I always look at it like how much time and money would it cost me if I wanted to build something to the same, you know, to get it to the same state.
Yeah, like the opportunity cost, right? And a lot of the time it just makes sense to get a head start, pay the ticket and get inside the concert or whatever, basically.
Yeah. If you do an Amazon business, to give you an example, if you have an Amazon business that you can buy that has 8,000 reviews for that particular product, that will take you, especially nowadays, will take you months, if not years, to get to, or a lot of money to get to that same number of reviews, right? Or SEO rankings. You know, SEO, as you probably also know, takes very long to do that. So if you start with a new domain that has no history, no nothing, to get, you know, a significant amount of SEO traffic will take 6-12 months.
Yeah.
minimum sourcing on the, to give an e-commerce example, to find first to find a, to figure out the product that you don't know if there's a market, if it's going to sell or not. Then you have to find a supplier. Then you have to, you know, put money at risk because you have to, you know, buy some inventory. You have to find a 3PL. This, it's the whole supply chain to figure that out. If you've never done e-commerce, that's a lot to figure out. Yeah. And I never had done e-commerce before I bought this.
All right. This was the first one. So let's go into that a little bit. So if you've never done, you know, e-commerce, I'm sure you can do some research online, which is like 1-2% of the knowledge you need, right? Like really you're going to learn by your supplier messing up and dealing with supply chain issues or figuring out what Amazon FBA is or whatever. So like when you looked at this business, what were you looking out for? Because in these prospectuses, they normally say, you know, like what does the owner currently do, which I never fully believe because like, you know, you're never, you know, you're often not going to say it's taking me 100 hours a week, right, to figure this stuff out. So like, what were you looking for in that part of the buying process to say, this is something I could operate from day one? Like,
So what I particularly did that time and now as well is I reach out to friends of mine of that are in e-commerce and get their opinion and really try to learn. I think one of the things, like you said, okay, reading online is one thing, but I think you can learn so much more to just, even if you don't know anybody, cold email somebody and you'll be surprised if you approach it the right way and be authentic, how many people will respond to you and are willing to jump on a call for 15 minutes and help you. So I sent basically the business, the listing to several of my friends that are in e-commerce or Amazon businesses and basically picked their brains of like, okay, supply chain, how, does this look solid? What are the red flags or what are potential pitfalls that I have to look for? What is the risk, you know, by buying this business versus, you know, building it? Stuff like that.
So I'm curious on for like the logistics part of like, let's say day one, you go into this business, we'll come back to like funding it in a second part of the show. But let's say we fast forward to day one, you've cleared, you've bought it for 300 grand. By that stage, what was the process like? A customer comes and buys a product from you. What happens from there? Was this all like run by Amazon warehouses or did you have your own warehouse? Like I'm curious like how you made that. You know, like, first of what it was and did you have to change anything as well?
Yeah. So in this particular one, they were not selling on Amazon. So they had a 3PL in the US, a 3PL in the UK and a 3PL in Australia.
And just for people who don't know, 3PL is third party logistics, right?
Correct. So they store so
someone
your products.
Else is, yeah.
Yeah. They have a warehouse. They store your product. Their software connects to your store, your Shopify or WooCommerce store that you have. Order comes in, will be sent directly to the warehouse. They box it and ship it to the customer for you. And then they bill you, you know, for that. That way you don't have to have all your stuff in the garage and, you know, your wife will not be mad at you that you have all your stuff
in the living
house.
Room.
In the living room.
Just what about returns? I'm assuming, do they take care of all of that too?
Some 3PLs do, others you have to negotiate. It's really different. In our case, we had to do the returns to ourselves because we had to clean the ramps and make and rebox it. Basically, that's something that our 3PL at that time was not doing. But that's a good question. Returns could be an issue for some 3PLs.
And just to go into, and I know I'm getting very tactical, but curious here.
Yeah.
So what are the options for this part of the process for fulfilling orders? There's 3PLs, and you said even within 3PLs, there's, you know, ones that do customer service, returns versus
returns.
Not. And I'm sure there's a bunch of range, like options there. The other one is you get your own warehouse or your living room, depending on the size, right? Are there any others? I guess it's like drop shipping, which is slightly different, where you don't have any inventory. You're just doing piece by piece, pretty much.
Correct.
Is there anything else I'm missing? Or are those the three main ones?
Those are the three main ones. Amazon has a service now too. I forgot the service, but where they can fulfill for you as well. So through your own website, so you sell on your own website, and then the order will be sent to an Amazon warehouse, and then they send it for you. But the main thing, it's always the discussion on their e-commerce founders is like, you know, the debate between 3PL versus in-house. And I actually switched. I made the move to go from a 3PL to our own warehouse. So we are currently doing it in-house, but not out of my garage. But
not your garage, yeah. That would get packed real quick. So yeah. Could you talk a little bit about that? Like, what made you switch there? Was that just having more control? Was it the margins? I'm curious, like, how you thought about that.
Yeah. I've not met one e-commerce founder that is extremely happy with their 3PL. It's something that everybody always complains about because packages are delayed or there's just a lot of headache dealing with the 3PL, mix up with orders. Or what we had experience with is there's just, you have no control when the packages go out. Customer orders something on Tuesday, only on Friday, the 3PL will send it out. And then you have SLAs, like those are contractual, that the 3PL has to ship it out within X amount of days. But they always put a very long, they have 7 days or whatever. So for us, there were a couple reasons. Was having control over the customer experience, and you order something in the morning, the same day it will be shipped out. Having control, because we're not only selling ramps, we're selling all kinds of pet products. And that way we could, ship products more efficiently together. And so shipping would go down, shipping cost. And there's going to be a pivot where when users start, 3PL is by far cheaper. But there's going to be a pivot point or where it actually becomes more cheaper to run it yourself.
Because you've hit certain economies of scale or whatever.
Exactly. Because 3PLs, they make money on pick and pack. So for each order they have to pack, they make money on receiving a container. So a container comes from overseas or wherever, they will charge you for that. So they have a lot of these surcharges
that all add up over time.
Correct. And especially if you, hit a specific daily or monthly number of orders, then running your own warehouse becomes cheaper. But what I've also learned now, running your own warehouse, it's basically a separate business. It's different, and I was very lucky. My reasoning to do it is because I found a really great warehouse manager that had 15 years of experience of building warehouse operations from scratch to, doing tens of thousands of monthly orders. So he did everything. He was like, I didn't do anything. He was able to find a warehouse. What kind of racks do you need? What kind of forklift do you need? What kind of boxes where you can.
Oh, wow. Yeah. This is not something you're going to just figure out reading a blog post, right?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And that was the advice I got from a lot of friends. It's like, if I were you, yes, you will save money, but your skill set is on the marketing side. I would focus. I think your return on time will be better spent on the marketing side versus the warehouse side. Yes, you will save, a couple dollars, but the loss of opportunity is probably higher. My next step was, okay, only if I can find somebody that I basically can give it 100% out of my hands, then I will make this step and put an ad out, did some job interviews and found this amazing warehouse manager. Okay,
so that's amazing. And then you hired him full-time, him or her. I think you said him, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you hired him full-time. And because you've already got revenue in the business, there's room for full-time employees too, right? Like, that's another benefit of buying a business. Like, you're not funding it all completely from scratch every time. So that I know that was quite in the weeds, but I think that's actually quite important detail, especially for e-commerce, because nowadays it feels like, you know, you'll see these YouTube ads where people are like, hey, come and buy this e-commerce site and just scale it to $1 million. Like, and there's so many parts of a physical business people don't understand or know. So that's the warehouse side. What about, and actually just last thing on the 3PL, is there a benchmark of like $100 order? What would you expect to pay like someone who's fulfilling an order? Is it like a range that people can
see? So it depends on the size and the weight of the product. But think of, you will get charged anywhere between $1 to $3 to pick and pack your order. And then they charge, of course, receiving fee. They charge if they need to use a shipping box, right? So if you have, I don't know, if you sell a mouse, the 3PL will use their own shipping boxes, and they do a markup on that as well. But the biggest one is the pick and pack fee of $1 to $3.
Okay. So if you're selling something that's very cheap, and small, like it's better for you to sell like probably a slightly larger product. Is that something you thought about as well? Like an optimal size, like that was like beyond a certain size. If you're selling sofas, it's obviously like a completely different business, right? Versus a mouse.
So if I had to do an ideal product next time, like the ramp is huge, right? Like it's maybe not like this big, but it is big and oversized. But the good thing, the margins are there to afford it. But if I'm jealous at friends of mine that sell something that is still expensive, still in the $70+ range, but is as big as this, because shipping is really cheap. And the storage fee is pretty cheap. Like storage fee is another thing that 3PLs charge, is like they charge you anywhere between $16 and $25 per pallet per month. So if you have 100 pallets of shit at the 3PL, those costs could add up really high. So if you have a sofa, there's maybe one sofa per pallet, right? So the storage fee of storing a sofa is really high versus...
I think that's why sofas take like months to be delivered, right? Because just the cost of them holding any of this inventory is like too much. Yeah,
exactly.
Got you. So, all right. So that's actually, you rephrased the question in a better way, which was, if you were doing it from scratch, like, is there an ideal size where it's in the middle? Like, so something small, but of still a decent value is...
Small, decent value, at least AOV, right? Like where maybe it's a couple... that your average order value is $70 and up, and maybe there's like three products. And then ideally a product that's a recurring product, like something that, you know, a ramp is not something that a person will keep buying, right? So something, you know, that's why supplements, for example, I'm not in the supplement space at all, but that the LTV of that is high because people will keep buying them.
Yeah, got you, man. Okay, that's interesting. Maybe we'll go into some of those things a little bit later, but that was very, very useful, man. Thanks for sharing that. Yeah. So you talked a little bit about the criteria when you were looking at the broker, you know, you're already getting these broker emails. Anyone listening to this, if you're interested, you can go and sign up on their sites. It's free. You just have to like sign an NDA when you receive the prospectus, I think, a lot of the time.
Yep.
And on MicroAcquire, you can pretty much just see it straight away. You've talked a little bit about it, but let's go into a bit more what you were looking for, right? Because you weren't necessarily looking for e-commerce, it sounds like. It just happened to be like that. What else were you looking for? Because you said there were like growth levers that hadn't been executed or whatever, right? So because a lot of these, I look at these all the time too, and honestly a lot of them, you're like, oh, this person's quite a savvy owner. They've tried everything, you know, that I would probably try. I don't know what other levers there are. So like, do you have like a checklist, or is it just in your head? Like, I'm curious if you have a process for this.
Yeah. So I don't have like an official checklist written out. I do just in general, it's in my head like, okay, A, just like you said, I don't like to buy websites from other internet marketers because they've, you know, probably over-optimized it already. So there's nothing really that I can do. Similar like real estate, I like to buy an older crappy house in an up-and-coming neighborhood, right? Where I can see like, hey, I'm good at painting and I can put some new carpets in and that will then increase the value of this property. I don't like to buy a new property that I cannot do anything, you know, to improve the cash flow. There are a couple of things that I look at. Is one is the paid acquisition, because paid acquisition is always going to be, without paid acquisition, you cannot go from 300K to 35 million, you know, in 2.5 years. So it's very hard. Maybe there's some examples, but it's going to be hard to do without paid acquisition.
Yeah, especially in 2021. And just to add to that really quickly is like, yeah. I spoke to like the founder of Nutribullet. They did it in an era where there were TV commercials, right? That worked at that level. And yeah. Then you can say in the 2000s, yeah, you turn on PPC SEO, where it was a little bit easier to kind of hack essentially. Whereas even yeah. that now, like you said, takes 6 to 12 months. And then the last thing is in the early like 2010s, the organic reach on Facebook was pretty high. So you could spread like pretty quickly. But like nowadays it's paid to play, right? Like you're only reaching 1 to 5% of people on those platforms. So just to add some more color to that, but yeah, go back to the paid acquisition is something you're looking like. In this case, were they just not advertising at all?
Yeah, they were not doing any Facebook ads, but they had a Facebook fan page of 1.5 million Daxon fans and huge engagement. And they had an Instagram account of, at that time, I think it was 400,000 followers. And anybody that knows about Instagram, it's very hard to organically grow an Instagram account to 400,000 with real followers.
Yeah.
They only were getting their sales from organic, either SEO or posting on their fan page or Instagram account.
Amazing. So,
I definitely look at paid acquisition or paid channels. Even if they're already doing it, then I'm looking at, can I scale that? You know, are they doing a really good job, or do I think there's a lot of opportunity to even scale more? And then I also look at other assets. In this case, they had an Instagram account, they had a Facebook with really high engagement. And an email list that they did not utilize because they thought,
oh man, yeah, this is, I'm getting excited just hearing you talk about it, man. That's amazing.
They thought they were not allowed to send emails to their customers. So they didn't even send emails to their previous customers, let alone, abandoned carts. There's all these, you know, if you're new to e-commerce, you know, look into Klaviyo. They can build all these, or you can build these automated flows that if a person comes to your website, checks out the product, puts it in the basket, but ended up not buying it, but the person still left their email address, you can then automatically send them an email the next day like, hey, you forgot something in your,
give
in your
them
cart.
A nudge. Yeah.
Yeah, give them a nudge. Like these flows really work. Or everybody hates them and everybody thinks it's annoying, including me, but they still work. It's the email pop-up, right? Like it's a small percentage that end up doing it, but at the end of the day, it still generates revenue. Like they were not doing anything of that. They were, to really simplify it, they had a problem with their dog. They built this product, but they were not internet marketers at all. And on top of that, in this case, the two previous owners couldn't see eye to eye. They were actually in the first call with me. They were actually, fighting, arguing while I was on the call. And
so that's a really good point. I want to go into that a little bit more because one of the things I've looked at, like buying companies before, and one of the things I'm looking out for is like, what's the motivation for the sale, right? Because yes. that, and what you just said there is actually obviously not great for them, but for you as the buyer, you're like, oh, that's a legitimate reason to sell a business. You're not seeing eye to eye and you can't keep going forward, or one person wants out or something like that, and they've just had enough of it. Versus like another motivation is they've tried to grow it and they can't grow it anymore. And those skills are the same as your skills. Obviously, like they could hit their, you know, dead end and you could take it further potentially. But mm-hmm. like, yeah, is that something you're looking out for in the buying process as well? And are there any like red flags that you've kind of figured out after going through so many of these potential deals, that where you say, oh, this looked like a good business, but this person said something that made me realize, oh, that's not a good reason to sell?
Yeah, like, and we always talk about our success stories. But the reality, there's a lot of also bad apples in, so you could buy, you know, I don't know the English word, like how do you say cat in the bag?
No. How'd you say it in Dutch, first of all? I want to hear that.
We say cat in the bag. I don't know.
Okay.
Is that the same in English?
I love when you, well, yeah, I kind of know what you're saying, but I just love when there's like a phrase that really hits in one language, and then when you translate it, you're like, oh, wait, that doesn't work the same way.
I know. Anyway, and I still make the mistake after 12 years. Sometimes I say a Dutch saying in English and it doesn't make sense at all. And we have really weird sayings. But yeah, going back, is that there's, especially on websites outside of my career or like Quiet Light, like if you go to flippa.com, not to knock down Flippa, but Flippa is an open marketplace, meaning anybody can just put their website up for sale. They can claim whatever. Flippa is not, it's not Flippa's job to really double check if everything is accurate. So you have to be careful, because if somebody really has bad intentions, with internet businesses, it's pretty easy to, you know, fake numbers, if that makes sense. Like what people used to do in the content space, you can literally buy bot traffic. So that's fake traffic to go to your website. So your Google Analytics looks like, oh, your site is getting massive amount of traffic, but it's actually all fake traffic. And I've seen tons of those things like that done on Flippa, where, you know, and that's the obvious quote unquote scams. What is also important to figure out is like, why is, like you said, why is this seller selling this business? Maybe this seller knows something that you don't know that's coming up. Maybe, I don't know, maybe a specific law is about to change. Maybe they, a bunch of competitors came on the market and he saw, you know, a couple, his revenue going down a lot. Like there could be all kinds of reasons. So it's always important to not only look at the business, but also be comfortable with who is selling at you the business, that they are trustworthy. And that's why I cannot recommend enough to use a service like Centurica, that is a due diligence company. So what they do is you find a deal, you make an offer with you guys come to an agreement. Now you do the due diligence, meaning you can go into the back end and make sure all the claims were true. Centurica does all that work for you, and much better, because they have seen all the scams out there, the red flags, and they know what to look for. That's money well spent.
Did you use them for this business too?
For this one. I've used them for another one, but I also I've been doing on Flippa. Like I think I bought and sold my first one on Flippa 12 years ago. So not to say that I'm as good as Centurica, but I've been, you know, around.
You've been around the block. Yeah. You've seen enough deals. And so you mentioned analytics there. So like, this is something that I've done in the past where I've got access. People have given me access to the Google Analytics.
Yes.
Well, like you sign some NDA or whatever to make sure you're not stealing stuff, basically. So you're like a savvy internet marketer. So like, when you go into analytics for a business like this, is that what you're looking at? It's obviously analytics and then Shopify or whatever platform they're using, right? Is the two main things you're probably trying to dig into?
Yeah, so I look at Google Analytics. If I look for, so for example, to check out the bot traffic, what you could look for is actually average time on site. That's one indicator. And it depends on the niche, the category. Some, you know, e-commerce have a shorter average time on site than a content site versus, an, you know, whatever. You can find the averages. But if you see a site only, the average time on site is 10 seconds, that means most traffic, most visitors come and then they leave right away. That's a red flag, right? Like if it's very low. So I look at average time on site. I look at traffic source. Where is the traffic coming from? And does that translate to what the seller's claiming on where most of the revenue is coming from? Is it from paid? Is it from, you know, SEO? Is it from email?
Yeah.
And there are a couple other things, but those are the two main ones.
And so just on that, because I know finding traffic sources of different channels is really important to you, right? Because you don't want 98% traffic coming from, you know, organic search, and then there's a big update on Google search and all of a sudden your traffic's wiped out. You know, that's just one extreme example. Is there like, you know, there's always dominant channels, but do you have like a number, like a percentage in mind, which is like a healthy spread? For example, no one channel that's more than 50% of traffic or something like that. Because I didn't really see any benchmarks. I think it's more like your own, how comfortable you are with it. Is this something you aim for when you're looking at the channel mix?
Yeah, it's, I like to see like an even pie, more or less. So 33%, you know, paid acquisition, 33%, you know, or 25%, and then four different channels. But definitely, like you said, nuts, over 50% of one, especially SEO. I've made that mistake. I've bought an SEO website, 80% was SEO traffic, and then several Google updates later, my traffic plummeted to like, it now makes 10% of what it used to make.
Oh, wow.
Just because of Google updates, yes. Diversify traffic sources is really, really important when you look at these deals.
And what about, in a similar vein, for e-commerce specifically, the difference between Shopify or your own platform revenue versus, say, FBA or Amazon revenue, which a lot of the time is another split, right? So is that something you were looking, were you looking for like, oh, I just want a site that has only Shopify or whatever platform you use traffic, and then we can extend to Amazon as like an opportunity? Or would you prefer to have them both running from day one?
Now I would look, I will prefer one that has both. Especially nowadays, like when 2.5 years ago, you could have bought an Amazon business for two, maybe three times the yearly profit. So what they, how the multiple works, they look at the last 12 months of profit, and then they put a multiple on it, times two, times three, and that's the asking price. Now, so the last 2.5 years ago, you can do that for two to three times the profit. Now it's double. The Amazon space is so booming because of, there's just so much acquisition, you know, happening because of, you know, huge aggregators and private equity funds investing in it. So Amazon, I kind of regret not, I started focusing on Amazon too late, basically. We do now, and it's a significant channel now, but I wish I started way before.
Got you.
But it was,
and if you already had that base, it was easier to optimize versus starting from scratch and figuring out
exactly
reviews and all the other levers there.
Yeah. I was like, man, like we went from 30K to a month in our own store to 150K to 250K month over month. Why bother dealing with Amazon? We don't own the customer. You know, it's the FBA fees are expensive, blah, blah, blah. But now I regret it. It's a really good marketplace to be on. So I think, especially now, as maybe some of your audience knows, that Apple made an update on their iOS, what makes advertising on Facebook more expensive, to keep it simple.
Yeah.
And every single, or most e-commerce businesses are actually hurting because of that, including us. So having a diversified out channels outside of your own store is really good. So
it reduces the risk or that reliance on those, right?
Yes. So, and even if you want to sell the business too, it's a really, it's going to be an added value for when you sell, if you have, you know, diversified channels and marketplaces.
Yeah. That was actually my next question I had, was on the paid side, because it sounds like that was a huge driver of the growth. Maybe, would you say it was the majority of the growth came from paid, right? Okay.
Yeah.
So let's go into that. And that's a bit of my background too. I also run a paid acquisition growth company, like a agency consultancy. That's kind of my core business. So I'm curious. So yeah, when you said the Facebook update or the Apple update, I shivered a little bit, because yeah, that's something we've all been having to deal with for the last few months at least. And just, let's just give, for people that don't know, the high level is Apple introduced in their latest is iOS 14, I guess, a new update where you might have noticed as a user, when you go to certain apps, you are asked permission, what can this app like basically track you, right? And they're basically, when you ask someone that, most people say no, because the way it's worded, you don't realize the implications of that, right? And you don't realize that, oh, I'm still gonna get ads, I'm just gonna get worse ads. You know, cool. Like there's pros and cons to the privacy debate, which is for another day, right?
Like, and we are biased too, right? You and definitely, I are biased.
Definitely biased. But at the same time, and just for me seeing these accounts and like how the numbers basically change overnight, right? Like, so right. If you were getting X revenue, let's just say you were making $100 a day in revenue, what overnight your revenue might now be reporting $60 a day, or, you know, 40% down for a lot of people I've spoken to. And that doesn't mean that your revenue overall has actually gone down. It might be just the way it's being attributed is being blocked, is being impacted. That's one part. And then the second part is just the effectiveness of the ads, is a simple way to put it, right? Like the more data Facebook, Google and the platforms have, obviously the more that you're able to do targeted ads. So again, we're not here to debate if that's a good or a bad thing, but that is kind of where we are today. Interestingly, from my experience anyway, Google hasn't been as impacted. Like they are being, well, we just saw the numbers just came out. Actually, their earnings just came out. And I guess we'll have to see next quarter to see if it's impacted that badly. But again, my understanding is because the core part of Google's advertising business is paid search, that is first party data, right? So when you type in dog ramp, you can still serve that ad because it's based on Google's search query and your intent as the user, versus this other type of advertising, which is like in the audience bucket or like programmatic, whatever you want to call it, interest based, where Facebook understands you are a dog loving person because you post pictures of dogs or you interact with other dog accounts on Instagram, etc., etc. And they will basically create these huge groups of 10 million people love dogs in the UK. And like, and you could, as an advertiser, you can go and create an audience and target those people. So now you're not able to target those people as well because less people are being tracked, essentially, right? So that's kind of how I see it. But now the question to you is, as the person who runs the business and potentially would want to do this again in the future, and it's been the biggest growth driver for you, how do you see this impacting you, right? Because in the future, if you saw a business and you said, oh, they're not doing paid ads, but now the paid ads might not work as well, like have you got to the stage where you think it's going to impact your decision that much? Or is it just an incremental change at the moment where it's just not working as well?
Yeah. And just a general comment is that, and you've been doing this for a long time too, where everything has cycles. You even mentioned it before, right? Like 12 years ago, SEO was really, that was the thing. And then Google made some updates all these changed overnight. And then Facebook organic reach was a whole thing. And that's why I was able to build the soap opera blog, was only because of that. And then 2 years later, Facebook made a change, and that's basically changed overnight. And I have actually a friend that had, you know, closed his publishing company because his traffic dropped. So I'm a big believer, like, everything has a cycle. And we had a bunch of years of amazing Facebook ads. I'm not saying it's over, but it definitely changed the landscape, this one. And I think we're actually going to get more updates and more, you know, things coming that will impact it more, basically. I don't think it's going to get better. I think it's going to get worse.
And it's kind of, I like the way you positioned it, though, which is, like, you're not like, oh, boo-hoo, the world is terrible. It's like, no, everything runs its course, and this is correct. Running its course. And we made the most of it while it was good. And now we're going to have to find some other areas, right? And I guess the macro question is, you know, like, there's always a conversation around owned versus rented audiences, right? Or, you know, like, you've got an owned list, like, you've got an email list. That's why email list is always so important. But even with an email list, Gmail updates their interface, right? And they add a promotions tab, and overnight the deliverability rates change. So it's still better than, 2% organic reach on Facebook, but there's always changes. So I think the challenge for people listening or people creating stuff is always understanding what is going on as to the best of your ability, hiring people who know better than you, who are specialists in that, like, when needed, like you said before with the warehouse guy, and then just having to adapt, right? And seeing where there's arbitrage, basically, like, you're seeing an opportunity where other people aren't necessarily.
Yeah, it's really rolling with the punches, and always be always aware of that. That, like, I think companies that get quote unquote lazy, like, oh, this is working for us, let's just do only this, and not, you know, thinking like, oh, maybe if Facebook makes a change, or Google made a change, or Gmail, or Apple, then overnight their business can be impacted. So that's, again, so important to have diversified channels. Yeah. So that could be like now, TikTok, you know, TikTok is we're still trying to figure it out. Not a huge success, but I see some opportunity that might work, but I don't know if we can scale it. But always never be afraid to test new things, because that's the only way to, I think, to winter those storms, basically, and things outside the box. So what we've built is Facebook groups. So when the Facebook organic update hit, we already had built groups of hundreds of thousands of people. Our fan page reach dropped like a bucket, and as also the traffic to our website from our fan pages. But because we had these very engaged groups on Facebook, and Facebook had a different algorithm for that, we still had massive traffic coming from there. And I tried to get the soap opera news in the Google News, soap opera website on Google News, and worked on SEO, and worked on, like you said, email, push notification. There's so many ways to reach your audience, but you always have to actively test, and try new things. You know, Snapchat works, it doesn't work for us, but works maybe for others. Give it a try. Pinterest, sure. Same story. Like, some people work.
For sure, man. On the testing part, when you're thinking of like budget allocation, so again, just using the number of 100 to make it easy for percentage wise, if you were spending $100,000 on paid channels, how do you think about allocating budget across those channels? Like, if you know Google and Facebook are working for you versus the test channels, do you have like a rough percentage in mind that you allocate to experiments?
Yeah, it's anywhere between 20 and 30% on testing channels. And within that, it's probably, you know, majority goes to testing something that you have a higher chance of succeeding, right? Like, if you versus like a totally new, you know, like, hey, let's buy a billboard.
Tests within the tests.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But definitely majority will always go to what is working, and then 20 to 30% tests.
And yeah, that's probably kind of the number I had in my head as well. The only thing I would add to that is it really depends on the scale of your budget too, for like, you might be at such a small scale when you're starting out that you haven't even scratched the surface with Facebook and Google, which will probably you can get to work for you. And like, if you have, like, if you're spending $20 a day, you should probably just put all the money in that one channel, right? Like, if you're starting out,
because
I think
a lot
of people, they overcomplicate and they say, oh, I need to, like, I'm using an extreme example, but they just do too many things. And what I think you need to get like one or two working to a good scale. And crucially, when you do test something, you need to put enough of a budget to like give it a fair chance at showing you if it works or not. You know what I mean? And for me, that's normally like, you know, it depends on, again, the scale of the company, but at least like 10K, right? Like at least 20K if you can afford that. Because if you're making a campaign for like $500, like you can see if people click and maybe purchase, but you're not running through the cycle of letting the platform start to optimize and learn who the right customers are and gain quality score on Google search, etc.
Especially nowadays, like learning phase is much longer now too. That's actually a good point. I should have actually brought it up. It's like at the scale that we are at, you know, and not wanting to be dependent on Facebook. Yes, we are always looking at other channels. If you're starting, you have to do actually the opposite and not focus. Because we got to the 35 basically with Facebook, Google, and email. Those were the three things.
Amazing.
Nothing else.
And so just the last couple of things on the different channels. So this has been super helpful, man. Like I think a lot of people who are actually building stuff, this is going to be very helpful for them. Affiliate is another area where a lot of people completely just forget about it. And in retail, it's normally like from when I'd worked in it in the past, sometimes 10 to 15% of revenue often can come from affiliates for a lot of retailers. I think the benchmark was like 10% from what I remember. I'm curious for you, and sorry, really quickly for people who don't know what affiliate is like referrals. So you're basically paying a percentage of sales, or you know, if a blogger or a YouTuber or a shopping comparison site sends you traffic, instead of paying per click, which is what you do on Google search, you pay a percentage of the revenue, right? So that can be 2%, 5%. In some cases, it's a recurring amount, whatever. So that's just what affiliate means. I'm curious for you, is that something that you guys have and what your kind of opinion is on it? Because, you've got to a certain scale as well.
Yeah. I love affiliates. It works better with some products than others. Affiliates tend to like push traffic where they can make the most money, right? So they're also in the business of making money. So if you have a product that is sells for $8 and you give 10%, doesn't really make a lot of affiliates excited. But there's tons of like, you can, there's ShareSell, there's CJ, there's like all these platforms that are very cheap for you to get on.
And those are the networks in between, right? So if you, and they already have a network, an email list of all these affiliates who can promote your stuff. So that's why you would use a network in that case.
Yeah. Still my experience, it's up to you that you really have to push it. You just still have to find. So what we do is we reach out to, for example, a very quick one is you Google the product. So in my case, dog ramp, best dog ramp. And there's tons of these review sites or blogs writing about ramps. And then I just reach out to each one of them, say, hey, we have the best dog ramp. What can we do to get our ramp included? We have an affiliate link, blah, blah, blah. In some cases, they do it for free in exchange for the affiliate link. Sometimes they charge you a one-time fee plus affiliate link. But most of them, they will do it because
they need to make money too. They're in the business of making money too. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
And especially if you've got a good product, right? Like if it makes it much easier for them. And so tangentially to this is influencers, right?
Yep.
Which is, in a way, depending on how they make money, most influencers are probably getting paid per post. But some of them do like revenue shares, and even in really good cases, like straight up collaborations, and you know, creating a product with them, like real brand partnership style. But I'm curious, for you, have you guys done much with like dog influencers, for example? Like there must be so many of those.
There's so many people that make Instagram accounts for their dogs, and you will not believe, like, we have accounts that we work with that are about the dog, just pictures of that same dog, that has hundreds and thousands of followers on Instagram. Because we have now all our Instagram accounts combined has a 5 million followers. So it's easier for us now to get these type of influencers excited, because we can do like, hey, we'll also promote your account on our,
Cross promo. So they're getting exposure too.
They get exposure. So there's tons of pet influencers, but we use a platform called Grin to find influencers and reach out to them. And they will.
How'd you spell that? G-R-I-N, is it?
Yeah, exactly. Grin.
Oh, I've never used that. That's cool. I'll definitely check that out.
Check it out, because they will find potential influencers. They reach out to them automatically. They can order. You connect it to your store, and then there's an actual influencer store then that you can give access to this influencer. They can order your product for free, and then it keeps track when the influencer also posts about you on their social media. So that's great. And we also use an agency that actually work with these higher end influencers, like, you know, semi celebrities, right? Like, you know, actress on The Bachelorette, and more. Those are more influencers that really have to push sales. So they really talk about the product and try to sell it in their stories. What is a big thing now is actually not so much the post, but stories and swipe ups. So if you're looking for influencers, make sure they ask for that. They talk about your product in a story and have a swipe up to your website.
Cause that's where they actually drive traffic, right? Or like they capture the lead or whatever on your side.
Correct.
Cause otherwise, yeah. And I mentioned this before on another episode, but like in previous job of mine, we had one of the top five most followed people on Instagram post something about our brand, right? And it was like maybe 100 million followers. And that engagement on the picture was great, right? Like maybe,
yeah,
it was millions of likes and stuff like that. But you can see the revenue, or like in this case, it was donations, because it was a charity I was working for, charity war. And basically, like, it hardly moved the needle. And then a week later, we would do an email newsletter where, like, the person was doing this for free. Like, they just liked the charity and they wanted to, like, spread the word. And they might have had, like, maybe 100,000 subscribers, right? And you've never heard of them. You'll probably never hear of them in the future either. But they had this crazy engaged audience on their email newsletter. And the people who were like following and subscribed, like loved that person so much, and they valued the recommendation. So it's kind of like Tim Ferriss recommending a health product in the 4-Hour Body versus, you know, like some random influencer who I'm just following because they're good looking, is a very different like intent. So I think that's another thing for people to think about, is like, who's the audience? Why are people following them? And then that's the qualitative stuff. The quantitative stuff is, like, actually look at the numbers. You can use certain sites. I forgot what one I've got it bookmarked somewhere, like Social Blade or one of these, to see like the percentage of organic reach, and to see like, do they have like fake followers? And even if they're not fake, like, do people really engage with their posts? So is there actually any platforms you use for like doing due diligence on those?
When we pay for we use an agency. The reason why we use an agency, yes, it's expensive because you pay, you know, percentage like around 20%. So if the influencer charges 1,000,
yeah,
then they charge you $200. But the benefit of using an agency is they've already often worked with these influencers and saw the metrics. They know, oh, this influencer, I've done a pet product before with, and you know, the ROAS, the return on ad spend was X, or the you know, the it was doing really well, and we rebooked it again 6 times with the same pet product, right? Like, so doing an agency really gets you to speed versus you trying to test out and doing research. They kind of know. So we don't really use for the pay. We let the agency do it.
Then you can outsource it, and they're like experts in it. They do all the logistical. Like, if you are having to cold email a bunch of influencers and DM them, yeah, like, obviously that's way beyond, you know, manageable for most people. So that makes sense.
Yeah. But if you do it yourself, I think what all you said was great. And then what I also would do is when you reach out, say, okay, we do a first time. I want to do a test. So make sure, but I'm only going to rebook you or sign a 6-month contract with you if I make, you know, if there's a return on investment for me. So make sure you don't overcharge me, right? Like, I want to build a long-term relationship, but, you know,
it needs to make sense.
It has to make sense. And okay, it's not black and white. Some influencers, they work amazing for your product, but the same doesn't work for me. Like you said, what I do always look at if this influencer is pushing products every other day, because if that's the case, that the customers don't really super trust this person, because it's like every other day, it's like, oh, today I'm drinking this tea, or today I'm using this product tomorrow. Right. And that's why Tim Ferriss would convert really well, because he's not pushing products every single day. If he recommends something, you kind of know he uses it and he stands behind it.
Completely. So that makes a lot of sense, man. No, that's really cool. So Grin, I think it's grin.co or something. I just looked it up. That's the website. People should check that out as well. Nan, this has been really thorough on the growth side. The last thing I did want to talk about was funding it, which we can get to in a second. Was there anything else more on the growth side that we've missed? I feel like we did a pretty good job, but anything else you think is worth mentioning?
Yeah. One last thing that is working for a lot of people I know is actually called whitelisting. So for people that don't know, what you can do, you pay an influencer or have an influencer for free that posts for you about your product, and they have a huge amount of followers. You can whitelist their account, and then you can actually create ads under their account. I'm explaining it really bad, but
no, I get you. So you use their post as their like organic post. You can use as an ad, right? So
correct.
So when someone sees it in their feed, it will say the name of the person and their logo or their face versus your logo from the brand account.
Correct.
Oh, so that makes sense. Yeah,
Tim Ferriss posts really well about the ramp. I can, with whitelisting, and we use a platform called Lumano. I forgot how to write it, but if you Googled Lumano and whitelist Instagram, for sure
awesome.
You will find it. Basically, you can then create an ad under Tim Ferriss's Instagram account. Of course, you don't get whole access to his account, but you can create an ad under his name and then put ad dollars behind it. Conversions are, you know, the ROAS is much better. So that's really the one thing that's working.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. No, that's a great one. And in terms of, that is run out of your main ad account still, right?
Correct.
So
yes,
you can still track the metrics because the click is going to your site, not to
correct
their site, obviously.
Yes.
Awesome.
And a benefit for them is like, hey, because, you know, some people ask like, why would they do it? The benefit is for them is they will get more engagement on their posts, and they get more followers because you put dollars behind it, and it's their ad or their account.
That makes a lot of sense.
So it's a win-win. And for people, instead of seeing it, oh, this is a product or an ad from AlphaPaw, they see, oh, this is an ad from Tim Ferriss or whoever, or this is a post from Tim Ferriss. So
yeah, it blends in a lot more. No, that's a really great one. I've seen people do that. I haven't done it myself, but I know it just makes sense that it would work better than just the brand most of the time anyway.
Yes.
That's great, man. That's really helpful. The last thing I wanted to touch on, again, we have covered some of this in previous episodes, so I didn't want to focus the whole hour on it. But this is funding, right? And the summary for me is that most people say, when you say I bought this for 300 grand, like 99% of the world doesn't have 300 grand, right? Like, or 95, I don't know the number, right? But and most people would say, oh, well, I don't have 300 grand. So they just don't want to, you know, even entertain this. And again, if you listen to the one with Ryan Culp specifically, we spoke about seller side financing, earnouts, like clawbacks, like all this kind of like advanced ways of funding, and also SBA loans. If you're in the US where there's a government, you know, incentivized or government run stuff that basically you can borrow money to buy these companies. The one type of funding which I've never got full clarity on is partnering with investors. And I'm curious from your experience, so I don't know if you've ever done it yourself or if you know people who have, but let's just say I'm someone, I'll just use me as an example. Say I'm Bilal, I want to buy a business. I've got experience in e-commerce. I've got a paid acquisition background, so I can add value in those ways. And maybe I even have some money, but I want to like take some risk off the table for myself as the operator. Right. And I want to say, well, let me let in an investor or someone I know who wants to like be involved with this, but they're not going to be running it day to day. They're just putting money in pretty much. Mm-hmm. Have you heard have you done this yourself, first of all, or know people who have? And if so, like, how does that usually work? And what is like a fair way to split this sort of stuff? Because I haven't really come to a like a conclusion and I've asked quite a few people.
Yeah. That's a good question. I've not done this structure myself before. That's why I had to start Soap Up myself and bootstrap it, because I had no friends or people that I wanted to invest in buying something. I've raised money from VCs, right? But I think that's something different. Yeah, that's a very good question. I think especially now with, you know, with Twitter, if you have a track record that you can show and you have a deal, I do think you can reach out to, you know, people on Twitter, especially in the micro career like community or My First Million community. There's tons of these communities.
So can I just rephrase it? Sorry, if it was you right now with your knowledge and skills and everything, you were the operator, and you've obviously got money and you can do it yourself, right, by this point. But let's just say for the argument of this scenario, you said, "Or I've found a deal. It is $1 million, and it's on quite light, and I've done the due diligence, or I want to, you know, and I'm gonna even put 100K in myself because you know I've got 100K to do it. I want to." Fill up the pie with other pools of money. And for the sake of this first scenario, let's say you've got a rich friend. Look, Sam Pa is your best friend or one of your best friends. He's also got lots of money. He's like, hey, I don't want to run this, but I'll put in 900K and I want to, or 800 or whatever. And I want to get a percentage of the business. First of all, would you even be interested in something like that? And secondly, like, how would you think about like the equity split? Is it as simple as, oh, well, they're putting in a bunch of money, so they get the equivalent of that, but then you get an extra amount because of the sweat equity or the fact you're running it? Because I've literally heard examples where one person says the operator would have majority, 60, 70%, and the traditional private equity one would be like 20, 30%. So it's a complete flipped. So maybe it just depends on the size of the deal, but I'm curious, like, if, you know, maybe you need time to think about this, and no worries if nothing's coming to mind, but I'm curious how you would think about it.
Yeah. Well, I think majority should go to the operator. And I also think the investor wants the majority going to the operator, because the operator has to be motivated. And that's the person that actually is going to make this a success or failure, right? So I used to be way too generous with equity. and like, oh, let's just do 50-50. And I'm definitely learned, you know, my lessons the hard way. That's really not the right approach. So in that case, I would try to still find a way to put a valuation on the business that is not the asking price, but a valuation of like, okay, we buy it for $1 million, but it's actually, you know, once we do XYZ, it's probably worth $5 million. And then basically do an equity split. Okay, you put $1 million, so that translates to X amount of equity.
I like that. Okay, that makes more sense because you're doing it more on the plan for the future value and the plan you're going in together. You're saying, hey, I found this opportunity. I think it's worth this amount. And that makes a lot more sense, actually. I like that approach.
That's something I would do. But there's no really rules. I think I've seen it all across the board. I've seen people doing 50-50.
Exactly. It's like very deal by deal. And I think the way I've thought about it is just like, it depends on the size. It depends on the opportunity. It also depends on the operator. Like, you are very different to a 19-year-old kid doing this for the first time, right? Like, you've done it.
Risk,
you've got a track record.
Right, yeah.
So the risk, exactly. So it's like any investment, it's risk reward. And for the investor, it has to be sold through as, this is the risk you're taking. There's less risk with Ramon because he has done this before than someone else. Therefore, you don't get as much equity, basically, right? So
yeah, Sam always taught me to think of if we do this, there's the worst scenario, realistic scenario, and a good outcome scenario. And then, so you could do the worst scenario, like, okay, if it doesn't work out, is there still something to sell? Are there still assets? Like, some ideas, it's home run or bust, right? Like, it's $1 million that goes all the way up in development. If the app doesn't work, there's nothing there to sell. But other ideas, there's still tangible assets. Maybe there's like, you know, an email list, or there's inventory, or some others where the investor is still leveraged, you know, for like, oh, even if it's a bust, we could still probably sell it for
do something.
We can maybe sell it for $500,000 and still get half of our cash back, or still sell it for, you know, whatever.
And actually, that's another benefit, right, of like buying, because you've got like a base that the value is based on, like actual numbers. When you're starting from scratch, often it is a, you know, especially a VC backed startup, for example, it's normally you're either going to win or you're not, like, that you need it to win to a certain size most of the time. That makes a lot of sense, man. I think that is a great point.
And investors, like, sometimes I got pitched to, and it's like, or friends of mine, I know that they first want to see something. Like, typically ideas on napkin are very risky because, like, who knows? It's going to take 1 month, a year to develop. Is a product market fit? What are the metrics going to look like? But if you have an actual business that's been around for 3-4 years, and you have the history that you can show, it's like, listen, look, it's been doing steady 100,000 a month with these channels.
Trying to figure stuff out. Like, you've got something to base it on.
Exactly. So
that's amazing, man. No, listen, man, this has been so thorough and in depth, man. Thank you so much for breaking it down.
It was a pleasure. It's awesome.
Like, really cool to hear what you've done, man. Like, you literally are living the American dream. So congrats on that, man. It's it's very, very cool to
see. You as well.
I guess the way I see it is cheesy, but as long as I'm like smiling and like happy to do what I'm doing and healthy, like, that's all I can ask for,
well,
man, you know?
It's cheesy, but it's true.
That's the thing. Doing this podcast, you know, you meet all these really interesting people, and the biggest life hack for me is like, I got to get like hundreds of years of experience of life, like their ideas and like what people have learned in, you know, the time I do it. And that is the best investment for me, right? Like, because it's great to like learn how a business works, but really, this is like how life works from a business person's perspective, because it's not only applicable to your business. It's like how you think about stuff, right? Like the way you broke down that problem. Yeah. Like, that's how you break down all problems. Like, you think and you reverse engineer, what sort of life do I want to live? How many hours a day do I want to work? How do I fix this problem I'm having with my kid? Like, I mean, it's not straightforward, but that's...
Is that why you started the podcast?
Yeah, the reason I started was because I used to work at Google, and I was there. This was 2015 when I started recording it. And okay. It was... I didn't have a green card, so I couldn't leave that job. And I didn't hate my job, but I was ready for the next step. I'd been there already at 5 years, by this 5.5 years, I stayed for 7 in the end. And what happened was, I just was like, I want to find examples of other people doing stuff that I think is interesting. Mm-hmm. And asking people for coffee sometimes works, right? But like, I can convince you, a complete stranger 2 hours ago, to come and spend an hour and a half with me, and I can talk about your childhood, which would be super weird at coffee, right? Like, if I was like, hey, I heard your mom kicked you out when you're 15, you'd be like, who the hell is this guy? So like, that was one thing. And then honestly, I just wanted to see people doing stuff in different worlds, and then try to tie it back, like the underlying principles is kind of what I thought. And then it kind of took me, as people who've been listening for a long time will know, like, I ended up, the second episode of the podcast was with the founder of Chaitwar, and I eventually went and worked there after meeting him for 2 years.
Wow.
And then another guy interviewed Jack Butcher on the podcast. Now I do a second podcast with him and Trung. So it's just like, I feel like I've gone through these different chapters, and it's quite cool that the podcast has evolved with me as well. And I'm no Tim Ferriss, but like, I love doing it, and it brings me a lot of joy, man. So.
Yeah. And I think it's something that this is one of the few things that no other platform can take away from you. Right. So we talked about Facebook, that's making exactly changes, Google, but you have an audience, you have a platform, that, you know, on Twitter and, you know, Spotify and et cetera, that, you know, you basically own. So,
and also even beyond, and that's definitely true, but even on, honestly, beyond that, like if I press stop on the record and I didn't even put this out, I already gained from this, and hopefully you did too. So it's to me, how I always think about it is like, the only way you can keep doing it long-term is if you enjoy the process, like you said. And for me, I have to love the people I meet, the conversations I have. And like, when I started it, I was quite purposeful around writing down, like, what do I naturally like doing? Where do I like to spend my time, where time just flies? And I said, I love like meeting interesting people and like having good conversations. So I was like, oh, well, why don't I just go and I'm already having these conversations. I should just record them, you know?
Exactly. That's awesome.
But yeah, man, thanks so much, man. This has been really fun. And let me know if you ever make it to New York, we'll have to hang out for sure.
Yeah,
I'll do the same if I'm in Austin. And where can we send people? Because I know you started posting some stuff on Twitter, right? It's Ramon van Meer. On Twitter.
Ramon van Meer, because Sam made me Twitter famous a little bit. And so, I'm going to start using Twitter more. Ramon van Meer.
Also, I'll Twitter share that in the show notes as well, man. And you listen, man, I will say, you said in the beginning, you're not that smart for some reason. You said that. I know what you meant by it, like compared to these other people, but you're clearly a very smart guy. To me, my definition of smart is like exactly what you're describing. And and like, I love what you've done, man. So congrats on that. And thanks for sharing that with the people listening today, man. Really appreciate it.
Awesome. Thank you for having
me. Cheers, man.